Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Mr. Knight. And I'm honored to have been invited to talk to you this morning. I only trust that what I have to say will prove of interest. I'm going to endeavor with the aid of some diagrams, blackboard diagrams, to review some of the most outstanding events in the history of the Earth as it is recorded in the rocks and the fossils which we see within a radius of 100 miles of Laramie. Now, when we approach such a grandly ordered concept of the history of the Earth, we have to leave the world of finite reality as we know it. We our sense perceptions dictate to us such things as time and space and speed and so on. And have to admit that the finite mind simply can't grasp the meaning of time. I don't know the meaning of a million years of time. I have no way of understanding. And yet we know that time has passed not only in millions, but hundreds of millions and billions of years are available to it. Now our story is the record, really, of two great groups of forces. Which, if we let this represent the Earth, one group is operating externally, attacking the surface of the exposed surface of the Earth, and have this group of forces, such as running water and waves, wind, what you will, been allowed to operate unopposed. The Earth today would be spinning through space covered by a universal ocean. And all the varied, complex manifestations of life which are developed upon the land, including ourselves, would never have come into existence. Now, we're here only because of the fact that there is a group of forces opposing. In fact, these forces enter the fray and emblazoned on their battle flags is there shall be no relief. I'm speaking of physical relief, not social relief. We all know that there is the Earth possesses relief. The total amount of relief, however, I could put within the width of that chalk line compared to the Earth as a whole. But it's very significant, meaningful, at least to land life. So there shall be no relief. Fortunately for us, and a host of other ones, there is a forces which are operating in opposition to these. And these we can summarize chiefly in movements of the crust, and the rise of liquid and gaseous rock-forming material from deep within the Earth, or of volcanic emanation. And related phenomena. This group of forces combine into a great cycle of erosion, transport, and deposit. In other words, while these forces create new highlands and are subsequently attacked, of course, they disappear. So much for a brief summary of the story. It's the record. Now we can break down this record in various ways, and I've simplified it as much as I can. I'm going to talk of it in terms of a great play. And we'll think of it in terms of acts and scenes. And I'm going to review some of the scenes, as it were, as if we had approached the Earth at different times in its past history. So we'll start then with Act One. Now, Act One is a tremendously long act. It's known to the specialists as the Precambrian time. And it is visible into a number of scenes. It represents 80% of all of geologic time. In other words, this act consumes, starts with about, in the neighborhood of 3,000 million years and runs up to 600 million years in time. MY stands for million years. And going from the past to the present. So I'm going to draw a series of diagrams, and we're visiting now this region as it looks. I believe it looks at the different stages in its history. It's a continuous record. So you have to break it up. We'll open the story then with a diagram going back 2,500 million years before the present. And we're going to have a crust and see in the cover of this region and this we call an unknown crust. No one has ever seen it. It's no longer. It's what must have been in existence. So we'll put it down just as a question mark. Now there arose through the earth this unknown crust a series of volcanoes. And they established what we believe to be a volcanic arc. So we can have here a heating conduit, a volcano, and build up on the floor of the sea and continued to rise, reached just as we have today. We have, and we have a volcanic arc. Become of the day, such as the Aleutian Islands or representative. And here we would have then coming into being, elevated above the land, above the sea, would be volcanic outpourings giving rise to more or less continuous. Now, we don't know where, with regard to this story, where this occurred. That is, the position is not known. Evidence is not available. Now, my area that I'm going to center on here would be southeastern Wyoming. We will say reaching from Cheyenne through Laramie to Saratoga and north to as far as, in other words, I'm going to just block off an area here, and we'll call this region in which we're going to concentrate, and we'll put Laramie down here near the lower part of it. In other words, most of the diagrams that I'm going to treat with will cover that general region of southeastern Wyoming. Now, this great cycle of eroding transport and deposit was in effect, has been in effect, a continuous, uninterrupted attack since the first rainstorm fell on the first slope and the first winds blew. Continuing uninterrupted attack, ceaseless and endless. The opposing forces are cyclic, rhythmic in their attack. They will withstand the attack for scores or hundreds of millions of years, and then they rebel, and new highlands come into being, new mountains are formed. So this attack is the same attack that's going on today, and some of the lava flows continued, spilled out, and covered this general region. And we could say we had lava or the fragmental ejecta from the volcano. There was probably a good deal of fragmental material that was also admitted. Enduring periods, intermittency or dormancy, we could have the fragment of debris washed down from the highlands by the into the sea and spread out, forming sediments, various character, coarse or fine. In other words, they're built up over this region, a vast sequence of lava flows and intermittent, embedded with the came into being a vast succession of have flows following in any order we might, and the fragmental, in other words, a series of bedded deposits came into being, derived for the most part from the highlands, although there is some lime deposits in them which suggests that possibly even life may have had something to do with it. So there comes into being then the first event, this thick succession, several thousand feet thick. I don't know if anyone knows the total thickness, aren't derived because it's now extremely fragmentary, but made up of an alternating sequence of lava flows and sediments. This goes on for scores of millions of years, and finally we come to the rebellion point. We set the stage for a revolution. And geologically we have revolutions, just as we have in human society. The old order goes down and a new order comes into being. It's interesting to note that these revolutions are triggered by a restless earth. And the results are that imbalance some way, new mountains are created, new highlands come into being, and the earth is subjected to great tangential pushes, and we find that this succession of sediments now, which were born here on the seafloor, is thrown into compressed folds. And period of crustal unrest. Now, along with that, we find that there is a great deal of granite comes into being. Well, my next diagram will be a diagram representing the makeup now, composition of the existing crust as we know it, covering this general region of south central Wyoming. After this great period of folding and intrusions of magma or liquid and gaseous, we now take a segment and I'm going to cut it down after it suffered extensive erosion which is made up of these highly compressed, folded remnants of the older succession of on the surface would form a highly involved, intricate fold patterns. And they would come and go as island-like masses, you might say, or a mosaic. Well, we would have remnants of them much of it is now is granitized, and we have a whole host of metamorphic rocks come into being in response to the chemical, physical heat, pressure, what you will, instant to this period of intense folding. So we can say then we have huge amount of granite coming in. We have granite gneisses, which is the remnants of some of the older rocks which are soaked up with granite juices. You can think of granite being the juice. And we have patterns going on here and there. So we get them, this is the first, the oldest fragment of the existing crust. And in this process, in this rise of this magma, the unknown crust was destroyed as an entity, at least. We haven't been able to distinguish it as such. It may be there, but it'd be like dropping a lump of sugar in a cup of coffee. You destroyed the lump of sugar, it's still there, but you can't see it. And so that may be so we come up then with that as the opening phase in this story. Now we're going to move up some hundreds of millions of years to this would be scene one. Reconstruct now a landscape. Go back now to a larger block, back to somewhere like we had before. But now our block is made up of this, I'll just use white, of this pattern granite and a whole host of related rocks, which are born of the metamorphism which the rocks underwent. And again, our position would be roughly here. Now we have new highlands. Date somewhere around less than 2.3 million. But we have now some highlands coming in. Our picture. And again, the evidence is too fragmentary to know just where these highlands occur. But the evidence is eloquent that they were in existence. We are located here now in our diagram. Then there was also a sea which covered the region. To shallow sea, apparently. And again, erosion was biting away at these highlands, carrying the inherited fragments, Lots of debris from the highlands to the lowlands as the river spilled out to the sea. And again, now there comes into being another vast succession of alternating sequence of sediments. In part, volcanic, some volcanoes, but there comes into being now a vast succession. I'll lower this a bit so it'll give me room enough to lay down over this region. And it's hard for the uninitiated, at least, to realize that the time involved. Here we have a sequence of beds of siltstones, sandstones, limestones, questionably tillites, glacial debris, and some eruptive rocks laid down, aggregating not less than 25,000 feet thick. How long does it take to lay down 25,000 feet of mud and sand, silt, comes in underneath it. One of the most interesting parts of this sequence is that there's a layer bed 7,000 feet thick, carrying in it, which carries what unquestionably the fossil remains of a low form of life, and they occur as reefs, and they are undoubtedly alga-like, alga reefs. And heads that occurred, which grew on the seafloor and were buried in the silts, which were carried from the mainland highlands. Of course, all this at the expense of the highlands. They vanished. We speak of the eternal hills, but there's no such thing. Highlands, mountains, go through a life cycle just like we do. And they're born, they're young, they mature, and they grow old, and they die, and they disappear. The only thing is, a life cycle may span 100 million years or more, but they still go through a comparable cycle history. So we have now born here and resting upon this older sequence. A great mass of sandstones. If you've ever been up to the Snowy Range, this would be a cross section. This would be Lake Marie, and here would be the scarp of that pronounced white quartzitic ridge. Here would be the Brooklyn Lake over here, Highway 130 would come around like this. After you've gone to leave the university camp until you come clear over onto the west side, you're traveling over the truncated edges of this great sequence of sediments. And this sequence in here, again, 7,000 feet thick, was at one time a tour sand, was on a long-forgotten beach and metamorphosed into quartzite and owes its relief to its durable character. It's cut through by a gap where two glaciers had lived here. And in here is the marble-bearing algal reefs buried in the This is, in other words, life in the order of magnitude of 2 billions of years ago. This starts here less than 2.3 thousand million, and comes up to about 1.7, 1,700 million years. Oh,
this is a neighborhood of 2 billion years that we have skeletal remains of organisms which were present and growing in very low form. It's true, they're simple-celled, low form of aquatic plant life, but nevertheless light, so that it, as far as we know, it's been continuous ever since on the Earth. All right, so much for scene two. Now again, we have we've taken off thousands of cubic miles of rock from this and deposited over here. Well, the Earth's crust can't stand indefinite. Man can't overload it. I'm sure the largest pile of rock probably man ever piled up was the Pyramid of Cheops. Herodotus tells it took 100,000 men 20 years to build it. And it didn't disturb the balance of the Earth, but if we're thinking in terms... Did you ever try to visualize a cubic mile of rock? Quite a... God, if I had a nice cube of cubic mile of rock out here on the Florida Land Plains, I'd have one of the wonders of the world. I'd be a millionaire. I'd just charge so much to see it. Cubic mile, but nature and time, even the minutest force in time, give it time enough, can produce the most profound results. And this is the story of limitless time. But we've disturbed the balance some way, somehow. And again, we're suggesting now, and this sequence comes folded and broken. However, the disturbance wasn't so violent. It wasn't folded nearly so violently as the earlier disturbance, but nevertheless, it was thrown into convulsions, as it were, and great breaks of arches and movements. So we can draw now a diagram again of our area, of this region, as it may have looked after this folding. And we're going to fold it rather modestly, except we're going to drop it down rather severely. And this whole succession now is thrown into a series of... There's one great fracture zone where we can fold it up. So if we came along, we would have some blurring at least folding up this. And they come and they go, just like the wrinkles on my sleeve, and it lasts for indefinitely. And we can, now this is all of this that I'm drawing on this scene two, or mid-Precambrian as the specialist would call it. And this is a great shear zone. It never stood as an overhanging cliff thousands of feet high at any one time. Undoubtedly, as it moved up, let's say again, rhythmic movements at different times, and it was torn back by erosion. So that, and here, and then beneath it is our old, highly crumpled, distorted crust. With the all kinds of invading, I didn't take time, as magmas and black gabbros, and dikes of all kinds of cutting through in the intricate pattern. And they mentioned that we have these ancient sediments now. 2.5 plus in their history with the granite and the granite gneisses associated with them, so that And over here, this continuation of the same pattern, mosaic, really, of remnants of the highly altered and darted crust, followed by granite. Now, this would be then the scene three in our story, somewhere around less than 1,600, we'll say, million years ago, probably at this period of folding, crustal unrest, mountain making, orogeny, whatever you used to call it, resulted in something like this. And then we have a prolonged, and then there was one more principal event that took place some, we know now, it's dated about 100 million years ago. There was another great invasion of granite, which came in, and we could indicate that as a different color. This is a very conspicuous and prominent rock type in this general region. This is called the Sherman granite. Takes its name from Sherman Hill. And I mention it because its prominence, as you drive from here to Cheyenne on Highway 130, while you're driving on Sherman granite from the summit to Granite Canyon. 15 miles is well away. You're on this, which, of course, now you're driving way down here somewhere. You're going down in here, but that's subsequent history. Driving over that granite which came in. So we have an older granite and a younger granite. We have an older succession of folded, potentially folded sediments and related rocks, and a younger succession. And now we're again destroying the highlands, and we're going to tear down and roll them down to a region of low relief again. And cut it off here, and we have something in the order of what is the end of the first act, or late Precambrian time. Well, we can come out now with so we have then the region reduced to moderate relief by erosion. And so we wander around over here, and we would see little or no relief. Here would be, however, this succession of ancient sediments standing and very steeply as they come down. You cross this great shear zone, and suddenly you leave this succession, which trend across the country like this, and drop over onto this succession, the older succession, just in a short distance. You cross this great thrust fault, sure so. So you drive now today all the way from Centennial on up to Brooklyn Lodge. You're on the older sequence rocks. Maybe some Sherman granite. And then from here over to Headquarters Park, you're on the younger succession of rock, and come back again as you go toward Saratoga onto the older succession of rocks. Well, that concludes pretty much the very brief summation history of Act One, or Precambrian Time. Remember that it opened more than 2,500 million years and closed at about 600 million years. 80% of all history of the Earth is incorporated. And I think we're very fortunate to have as elaborate, you might say, documentation of that record as we do have in the mountains to the east and the west of us, particularly the mountains to the west of us. I think it is exceptional to have that much of this. After all, the record is a discontinuous one. There are many lost intervals where erosion was going on and there was nothing positive, it was all negative. Time was going on, but it was negative time in the fact that there's nothing left. Nowhere in the world, at least on the land surfaces of the Earth, do we have a continuous record of Earth's history. It's a patchwork here and there, where when this erosion is going on at one locality, deposition is going on elsewhere at the same time. So while you might have a negative chapter in Wyoming, you have a positive chapter down in the Mississippi Valley. As Wyoming now is being eroded, it's standing high. It's the second highest state in the Union. It has a mean elevation of 6,700 feet. And it's every mile of it is being eroded. Come back 100 million years from now and it'll look quite different. In other words, erosion will have to cut it down unless in the meantime the crust gets restless underneath and starts to move. Again, let me emphasize that you can't, the only way I can put my finger into time is all we know is that we have abundance of time. In fact, in my industry, you know that just 58 years ago, I was sitting where you were in this very room taking my freshman course in geology. It's quite a generation gap, isn't it? And we were told that the Earth was 100 million years old. That's as far back as even the most imaginative could stretch it. And in the ensuing time, we've learned to read the radiometric clock, and we pushed that back 40 or 50 times. Because this clock, you've all heard of it. If you have a action, a constant action, and that you could measure the amount of the action, you can compute time. The action has to be constant. Unfortunately, we do have that in the radioactive minerals. But if you have a constant action, and then you can measure the amount. Using a homely example, you'll say our action is driving down the highway at the rate of 60 miles per hour. But we're going to maintain a constant rate. That's action. And you'll say we go for 60 miles, that's an amount. It doesn't take a genius to determine how long we were making the journey. You divide the rate into the amount and you come out with time. That's the basis upon which this calendar time is made. Radioactive substances dissociate themselves, breaking down into other substances, and the amount is measurable very accurately. The rate is a constant, measurable. Yet it's a highly specialized technique of determining, but we come up and it's checked out all over the world. And the most spectacular one was just recently was carbon-14, which the anthropologists enjoyed so because it gave them a measure of man's early history. All right, I'm going to... I've still got 10 minutes, enough to cover the next 400 million years. The Act Two opened about 600 million years ago and closed about 400 million years. And that's known as the Paleozoic. Yeah. And they say it spans the time from 600 million years to about 200 plus million years. Enormously long time, but not. The only way to represent this is the two seas. Scene one would be early Paleozoic time, and scene two would be late. Time won't permit me to go into too much detail. We have to now expand our concepts a little to get our setting. I'm going to go back now and draw a fragment of the continent, showing you the dominant physical features which control during this era. Well, we'll start with, we lay out a little map here. This is Wyoming, Colorado, Utah, Nevada, Oregon, Montana. Oh, we're here. And during Paleozoic time, there was a great trough. Seaway swept through what's now probably should put the greatest axis up a little farther to the west. This is Nevada. This is Utah. Somewhere along the was an area beyond the 100 second meridian, probably. We know there were some marginal highlands. Unquestionably. That would be along the Pacific border of the. Then we come down into a trough, which was filled up with them. Come out into the Rocky Mountain region, and we come into a long, flat platform, sometimes spoken of as a shelf. And continue on. Take a block out of it again. This would be the sea came and went repeatedly. And it moved up into this trough and out over onto the shelf. In other words, we can think of the sea as covering this region, the shallow sea sweeping out. The interesting thing is that during the various periods of there was considerable unrest. There was apparently this region of Wyoming, southeast Wyoming now, again our region that we're concentrating on is here, was elevated and depressed a number of times. Regionally, just as the sea and the sea advanced. But there came into being, again, a vast sequence of sediments, which thickest down here in the middle of this great trough, a deuce incline, and thin progressively as we come out onto this shelf. There's evidence that the Only a very insignificant amount of this is left over this region because during times of elevation above sea level, erosion took its toll and when it was deposited. But for those that are up until just recently, 4 or 5 years ago, we thought that this region was elevated above the Paleozoic transgression. Down here 20 miles southeast, we find some small limestone inlier in the granite, which carries fossils of Cambrian, Ordovician, Silurian age, so that there's some indication that these seas, the picture you think of now is a transgressing and regressing sea as they swept out and up and down, you know, across the continent in response to movements. And if we depress this land, the sea advances, and if we elevate it, the sea retreats. Did you ever try to picture what the continent would look like if the underpinning of the North American continent would give way and be pressed just 1,000 feet? That's only 1/64th of total relief. Would you get on a boat at North Platte, Nebraska, and get off Pittsburgh? In other words, the whole Mississippi Valley, as we know it today, would be inundated with sea, sweep up from the Gulf of Mexico and south and the Antarctic and the Arctic, and you'd have a seaway 1,000 miles broad, just 1,000 feet. Well, as I say, the total relief of the Earth is 64,000 feet. That's only 1/64. You can see, don't wake up in the morning, you expect the Gulf of Mexico to advance over the Mississippi Valley. It isn't going to. But it has in the past, and probably will again, that again, some millions of years probably would transpire before that happened. Good morning. In my presentation on last Thursday, I likened the history of the Earth to a great play, divisible into its acts and scenes. And I gave you a brief rundown or summary of Act One, known as Precambrian Time, which consumed about 80% of all the known past history of the Earth. Act Two was the Paleozoic era, which I divided into early and late. And the bell caught me, I think, just as I was finishing late Paleozoic time, and I will start from there, and you'll have to move along merrily, and take in the Mesozoic and the Cenozoic era. Recall that we were centering around the Rocky Mountain region adjacent to Laramie, the radius of 100 miles or so, and that in the late Zoic time we had a mountain system evolved, rose, extending southward into Colorado and continuing northward into Wyoming. And that to the east, we had a shoreline sea which came and went. Remember that as the Earth's crust moves, elevated, the sea withdraws, pressed, the sea is advancing. So we had a sea that came in probably from the east to the north,
And we had the rivers draining from the highlands to the lowlands, as rivers always have, and they were carrying their inherited burden of rock fragments, as rivers always have. And we had a coastal plain. And there was deposited on that coastal plain a series of sands, conglomerates, coarse textured fragments which were washed out as alluvial sands, the little deposits. And as we come farther toward the sea, we get finer textured sediments. Sediments are usually coarser as we approach their source of supply and become relatively fine as we. And we get here some marine limestones, thin marine limestones that are laid down beneath the sea. And here are the rocks which surround us. We go out to the end of the street and we'll find some of these limestones flanking the west flank of the Laramie Range, and some of the sandstones, which the finer textured sandstones intercalated with them. So this was the closing stage, as far as we're concerned, as the sea gradually did advance, and our limestones had to continue across as the ancestral Rockies, as we call them, disappeared under the constant attack of erosion. In other words, they disappeared and their products were swept in the big cycle of erosion, transport, and deposit down onto the coastal plain and into the shallow sea. Now we're ready to take up chapter 3, or act 3, I should say. And that is the Mesozoic world. Or these calls firmly, we call it an era, and it will continue to interest us from about 200 million years up to about 60 million years. The time span would be 140, 50 million years. And it's divisible into three acts. Act 1 is the Triassic period. Act 2, and I'm putting these superposed as they occur in nature, is the Jurassic. Period, and then Act 3 is the Cretaceous. And these are all represented in our region. But we'll now have to expand our concept a little and go back to the regional diagram. You'll recall that during the Cenozoic era, Wyoming was a shallow shelf rising out of a deep seaway. In other words, I'm going to go back now and draw a diagram of a portion of the Cordilleran region, as we call it, where we'll put Idaho and Utah and Wyoming and Colorado and Oregon, California. Called it during Paleozoic time, there were some highlands out here on the Pacific margin, very extensive highlands. And they gave way to a seaway, which rose so that the basement complex rocks, these old Precambrian rocks, and that here was the site of the deposition of a vast sequence of sediments, which aggregated on the borderline between Utah and Idaho, 40,000 feet thick, and they became comparatively thin as we come on to Wyoming. We're located here, of course. They are thicker on the west and thinner on the east. But the seaway, this great seaway, the trough, was out here. Now we have one of these periods of crustal unrest, period of mountain making. And a rather interesting thing, this happened over and over again. One of these great periods of crustal unrest take hold. With this early great build up, great tendential pressures, thrust. The region that had been the depressed area and the recipient of miles of sedimentary fragments of rocks or limes derived from the life of the sea now arise and become the highlands. So during the Mesozoic world, or during this Act Three, we'll shift our physical makeup. These mountains have disappeared. All this region becomes now a highland, and our seaway, maximum trough, shifts also to the east. Interesting. So now in the general geography of this, if you please, we'll have highlands, and we will have seaway, and these highlands will reach from across what's now the Utah Idaho, and we will have our trough coming in, and seaway coming in our diagram now will look something like this. There we have Bowens out beyond what we call Reno, we call this Salt Lake, we call this Laramie, get our bearings. And now our deposition takes place, and we get the building up of the vast sequence of sediments of Mesozoic age, thickery along the western border of Wyoming, but still maintaining great thicknesses over the region. Our region, which we'd say was indicated by that. And this was, it was in and out of this trough. The sea advanced and retreated a number of times and expanded out and left. So it is in to the south, probably. The remnants of the old ancestral Rockies down in Colorado also are exposed, but I can't show that on this diagram. So that while we had the period of great crustal unrest out here, in which these older Paleozoic rocks were thrown into folds, and the still older basement complex rocks beneath them, here there was little crustal disturbance, so far at least, as the compression, and so we passed, you might say, from Act Two to Act Three in this region without any marked break in the continuity. In Act Three, Scene One, there was deposited over this region a succession of sands and silts, which are conspicuous because of their uniform red color. And it happens the campus is built on this succession. Every time we dig a hole a few feet deep through the alluvial cover, we come into red siltstones or shales, and these are conspicuous rocks wherever they occur because of their color. There have been debate for many years as to their origin, their high oxidation. The iron is in ferric form, suggested it was aridity. The absence of fossils, it's one of the most, you might say, impoverished of all the succession of rocks, in the fact it is devoid of evidences of past life, led to believe that it was deposited as an arid condition. Real recent studies, however, suggest that it probably was deposited, some believe, beneath the sea because of its uniformity over long distances. but we have a red bed, and this becomes one of our most noted formations. And we call it throughout this region the Chugwater Formation. Takes its name from Chugwater, which is a stream, and the station on the Sinet, some 70 miles to the west-east of us, and a rather unusual name. You don't see it very often. And it's a formation, which was laid down and they get several hundred feet thick under the campus. It's about 700 feet thick. Now, that is spread over to the west, all of the thickening as we go again toward the source supply. Now we have, coming into the picture, one of the most interesting chapters in the past history of this region. We have here, our surface would be here, we'll see. These are a vast floodplain. Well, first the sea comes in from the north. I have to keep my seas, which is filled with marine fossils, and its shoreline, it passes right through Laramie and comes down to the south and goes out to the west. And so we have now a shallow sea invades this region and thins out, and in it, derived from the adjacent region, are laid down a succession of shales and sandstones, which carry marine organisms, both invertebrate and vertebrate. We find here that oyster beds, squids, deep fish, and rarely but find some of the great marine swimmers that evolved early in Mesozoic time. So we have a series of sands and silts then being laid down, mostly beneath the sea. And we go beyond the sea, we'll have a shoreline sand, the same marginal to the sea. And it happens that the shoreline has fall somewhere between Laramie and Centennial to the west of us. Because at Centennial we can find the marine fossils, but here we don't. This is called the Sundance Sea. Jurassic, the Jurassic Age, which came from the north, spread out, and then after laying down the thin veneer, which thickens as we go toward the big trough, seaway, and it withdraws, goes back the way it came, apparently, and left. Now a monotonous, flat floodplain. Hard to conceive, there's hardly any surface. Rivers draining chiefly probably from the west and from the south, coming out of the highlands, drained across the Rocky Mountain region as slow, sluggish streams, meandering bayous and so on. And there was an abundance of semitropical vegetation. It's a little hard to visualize palm trees growing in Wyoming, but we had palms, and we had cycad palms, we had rushes, a vast semitropical world over this vast floodplain covering hundreds of 100,000 or more square miles, devoid of any marked relief. And the silts and the sands which were laid down coming now from the... And this is one of the most spectacular chapters in our story. There's this floodplain evolved, and buds were being deposited on the... along with the area silts and sands. They arrived at the beginning of this region this vast host of giant reptiles known to you all as the dinosaurs. They marched in here as an invading host, found the climate, condition congenial for their survival, and they apparently continued to survive without interruption and going through a vast evolution for something in the order of magnitude of 70 million years. These, you remember, are reptiles, cold-blooded, smoother, scaly skinned, egg-laying, and are the dominant and largest forms of land life ever to evolve. I can't take time to dwell upon them, except I might mention one who was noted, rather modest chap. You could just about park him in this room. But he, indicated here, he is noted for he was one of the sports. And I use the word sport now as he covered with excrescences. In other words, he's dolled up. He had a double row of massive plates along his back, which probably had some protective significance. And they were probably covered with horn sheath. Must have been rather costly to develop and maintain, and then he had some two pairs of 3-foot spikes on the end of his tail. We're not so concerned with his ornamentation as we are with the fact that he was one of the enigmas of all time. If we study him, we find that he had a brain in the usual place, about as big as a golf ball. But if we try to back as he passes through the pelvic girdle, he had an emergent and a large nerve ganglion and a secondary brain which is 20 times as large. And this raises the question of what was nature experimenting with? How could an animal function with two centers, nerve centers, or two brains? Let one wit to commemorate this situation with this jingle that you might enjoy. Behold the mighty dinosaur, famous in prehistoric lore, for you, not only for his weight and length, strength, but for his intellectual length. For you'll observe by these remains the creature had two sets of brains, one in his head, the usual place, the other in his spinal base. Thus he could reason a priori as well as a posteriori. And no problem bothered him a bit. He made both head and tail of it. So wise was he, so wise and solemn, each thought filled just a spinal column. And if one brain found the pressure strong, it passed a few ideas along. And something slipped his forward mind and was rescued by the one behind. And if it erred, he was caught, he had a saving afterthought. And as he thought twice before he spoke, he had no judgment to revoke. So that, and he could think without congestion upon both sides of every question. Really, the dinosaurs, they culminated in the giants that are, we have a big one. He came in during this time. It's mounted in the museum. 75 feet long and 15 feet high, probably weighed 40 tons. We don't know exactly, but somewhere in that neighborhood, 10 times as big as an elephant, so far as the weight is concerned. All right, so much then for Act Two, the Jurassic period. First, a marine succession with some dance. Laterally, and this takes its name from its original locality, and the Morrison Formation from Morrison, Colorado. And it had been called the Como Formation from Como Bluff, where these dinosaurs, the most famous quarries, were excavated back in the 70s and 80s of the last century. Now we're ready for the Cretaceous.
And here we have the continuation of the general United States state setting, highlands to the east, to the west, to the south, with again with the rivers coming down. And we had a sea come in now from covering this region, a great seaway which swept in and probably joined the Gulf of Mexico with the Arctic. A little difficult to conceive of a sea 1,000 miles wide, maybe, joining. And this sea advanced and retreated. And there was a vast succession of sediments laid down in part beneath the sea and in part upon the land. And this was one of the interesting periods in that the succession upon the land carries the coal, which we have such abundance. In other words, we had sands and silts laid down through thousands of feet of thickness at the expense of the highlands, Asian highlands. And we have to have more highlands. These highlands probably went through as more than one impulse of uplift and supply. And then as we come to the shoreline, we find that we have laid down rocks, silts and sands, as we, and as the sea shifted back and forth, which it did, the shoreline, of course, shifted its position across Wyoming. And we could trace the shoreline. Here the wrecks contain the remnants of the land life. And it was during this time when vegetation began to take on its more modern aspect. The medieval trees, the conifers, and the palms, what you will, began to give way to the deciduous trees. And later stages, we have oaks and elms and sycamores, sassafras, what you will, semi-tropical world. And then, of course, we have the Greek reptilian host, the dinosaurs, whose remains were entombed. And we go out to sea, and we find oyster beds. And we know enough about oysters to know that they never got ambitious and tried to leave the sea. If we go out here as we can and find an oyster bed within a few miles of Laramie, why, we know peradventure of a doubt that the sea was here. You never saw an oyster climb a tree. In other words, a whole host of marine organisms which are preserved as fossils. So, and then I might interest you too that much, not all, but much of one of our great resources, our great heritages, of our oil is entombed in the reservoirs in this marine succession, while our coal, which is derived from the land-living vegetation, is entombed in this succession. So these rocks are especially significant because they play such a vital, significant part in our economy, not only present but in the future, as these vast coal resources with seams 100 feet thick, which is phenomenal. Pittsburgh became the center of the steel industry on a 10-foot coal seam. And yet we have seams of some bituminous coal 100 feet thick. It's fantastic. Took probably 100,000 years for that one seam to come into being. All right, now we're ready so much for Act 3. We're ready now for Act 4, which is more spectacular, and that is the Cenozoic era, reaching from some 60 million years to the present. In
now again, nature has shifted the vast burden of rock fragments from the highlands to the lowlands and built up here a sequence of rocks 30, 40,000 feet thick. Here over in this region, it's 15,000 feet thick. Not further west, along the western border of the state, it's nearly twice that thick. And we've now searched apparently the capacity of the Earth's crust to support it. Something happens, hard to say what, except that another period of crustal unrest evolves. And we're going to throw now this great succession into a series of wrinkles, upwards and downwards. All of these, and all of the underlying rocks, of course, were involved in this. So we come out then with the major pattern, physical pattern of the Rocky Mountain region as we know it today. In other words, the upfalls become the mountain ranges, and the downfalls become the intermontane basins. So that the physical, major physical features, as they evolve during this period of crustal unrest, on this, where we change now the pattern. Now, is it in the area of our interest? I can't take and draw out all of these folds, but reaching from the North Platte Valley to the west of us, to Cheyenne, the east of us, there came into being two upwarps, two major upwarps, and an intervening minor downwarp. Now all of these previously deposited rocks were involved, and so we have here this succession aggregating in this region some 15,000 feet thick, 3 miles thick, sands and silts, what you will, laid down. Very thin veneer of the Paleozoic rocks, almost wanting because it was destroyed. And there may be a little coming in on our western border, but almost had wanting. And beneath that, the highly contorted and folded and broken basement complex, or the Precambrian rocks, underlying everything with their intruded igneous phases of granites and a host of other. So we see now the rise of two upwarps, wrinkles, and an intervening downwarp in this area. Now, inevitable, just as soon as these upwarps broke base level, sea level, you see, they were attacked. The inevitable erosion. And it wouldn't be long. In fact, that is probably the rate of uplift. We know nothing exact about it. It was relatively slow. But it wouldn't be long until these rather young and not too highly indurated rocks were attacked and eroded, and we would have useful canyons cut on the flanks of these rising folds. And the rock fragments, nature doesn't destroy them. It makes smaller fragments out of larger ones, but she transports them normally from the highlands, and they come to rest. And inasmuch as this downwarp became a basin, now we call it the Laramie Basin, and this upwarp to the east of us, and we'd say Laramie is located here, this would be the canvas on the flank of the, we call this the Laramie Range, the Laramie Mountains. On the east end, these would be the Medicine Bow Mountains on the west. In other words, the basic pattern, you know, was the front and so on. Now there starts to come into the picture a younger succession of rocks, which are locally derived. And they're caught up in these basins as these drainage rivers poured out, as rivers have, dumped their inherited burden of rock fragments, and we begin to get a younger succession of sediments, which now are laid down nearly horizontal, which is true of all the sediments, at the expense of the local highlands. In other words, not only that, but we find that there were some places there were lakes where these streams entered into and were caught up, and we had some spectacular lakes. Not so much right in this area as farther west of us. It's hard to visualize a lake covering 10,000 square miles in Wyoming, but we had them during the early stages of this. In other words, we're now faced with this dual movements, compressional strains being thrown up, folding, and the inevitable attack downward, up and down. Now, at no time were these commensurate, probably. In other words, the uplift was matched by the down cutting. It's conceivable, but it would take a very long time. The uplift was more or less what came in cycles, repeated, active for a long period of time, and then quiescent, and another activity. But of course, the down cutting was constant. As long as the water flowed downhill and the winds blew, they down cutting. And these mountains began to lose of their substance, and the products of their thing were dumped into the adjacent basin. So we began to build up then a sequence of sediments filling the flanks of the rising fold. And then we also find a very marked change in the life. The dinosaurs, which had roamed this region fairly without interruption for 70 or more millions of years, disappeared. One of the challenging thoughts, why? Why did this successful group of reptiles finally succumb? This big copper-plated chap out here was one of the last. He doesn't look like he was on his way out, but he last. He didn't survive this revolution. In fact, they went down all over the world because this revolution was worldwide in extent. Not only movements in the Rocky Mountain region, but in South America and elsewhere as well. They disappeared. There have been 20 ideas advanced as a cause of their disappearance. Probably they simply couldn't meet the competition of a changing world. Their food supply went as we had advanced and changed the character of the vegetation, and anyways, they just disappeared. And then coming into the picture and picking up their, and now in the absence of the competition of these, this horde of reptiles, we find the beginning of the great mammalian class. The warm-blooded vertebrates covered with hair, bring forth a young alive and struggle a young, much higher order. Powerful four-chambered heart, body constant temperature, so on. They had their beginnings in late Paleozoic, late Cretaceous time, but apparently they got nowhere in the competition with the great reptilian horde. But as soon as the reptiles vanished, they took off, and we find as we go up through this succession, one of the most magnificent stories of evolution to be found anywhere, as we trace, for instance, probably the best documented is the horse, from a diminutive little animal that I could park within the space, up to the horse we now know, tracing successfully. And in this you might remember that if you have a succession of sequence of any objects superposed one on top of the other, you have established a time-space relationship. The floor is... table rests on the floor, the stand rests on the table, and the box rests on the stand. You know, peradventure of a doubt, the floor is oldest in time. It had to be there before the table could be put upon it. So as we go up, then, from the bottom of the sequence, we're going from the past to the present. In other words, that's a version. If you start climbing a scarp, here's a... hill, and made up a sequence of beds of rock. And you start down here at the bottom and start climbing. As you climb the sequence, you're going from the past to the present. In other words, this bed had to be in existence before this bed could be laid down upon it. The only alternative, we turn the whole thing upside down, and that happens very, very rarely. It doesn't very happen. In other words, It's called the law of superposition. It means that younger rocks rest on older rocks. So as we come up through this succession, we find it. Now I'm going to allow the action to continue, and I'm going to allow erosion to cut through this blanketing succession of sediments and down into the earth. And we'll come out with a... And I'll also allow some great fractures and displacement along those fractures, because as the fold became too intense, the rocks could no longer stand it, and they broke, and the strains were released by movement along the shear zones. And I'll give you a picture of what this region might have looked like 50 million years ago. And if I'd had the option at any time in the past to visit it, I think I would have chosen this time, because I think it would have been spectacular. I don't know what the relative height of the mountains to the basin floors attained, but they must have been far greater than they are now. So we will start over here then, and again over here at little town of Saratoga in the North Platte Valley. And we'll come up into the Medicine Bow Mountains, and we'll come down onto the floor of the Laramie Basin. And I'm going to put a big fracture in here, just whereby these older basement complex rocks were broken, and the upturned and truncated edges of the Mesozoic rocks, we'll say, were exposed here. This would be while the cores of the mountains now, the basement complex rocks, were exposed. So we have the... And remember, this is the old, highly distorted, folded, broken. We come down onto the... we come across to the other mountain range, and we come up where we'll have the flanking sediments. And again, we'll say that there is a magnificent mountain range. And we'll drop down on the Cheyenne side. And these would be the folded Mesozoic rocks. And in here we would have also highly folded with minor folds of these Mesozoic rocks. And these again would be the... with the basement complex, of course, going under. Yes, very good. Straighten that out. And coming out on the crest of the next upfold. In other words, the mountains have lost their capping of the Mesozoic rocks. Straighten this up. Let this come up flank entirely. That would be a little more realistic. Here we have then the magnificent mountains. And of course, young mountains are always vigorous, just as youth is vigorous. They lose their vigor as they are torn down. And then we have the younger rocks. Which were being built up, were being torn off by the mountains and being built up. Some of these are extremely coarse against the mountain front. We have rounded granite boulders, almost unbelievable, 10, 20 feet or even more in diameter, where they were rolled out apparently during floods, on high alluvial flood cones, and rolled out. Indicating at least that there was some great relief behind these mountains at this stage. The same thing would play over here. And I show you that today, if you were to make a journey between Laramie and Cheyenne, you would have a very different trip than the one you now take, as these mountains were vigorous, high. Actually, today, the mountains rise above the floor of the Laramie Plains by about 2,500 feet. I don't know what the height was from the floor, but it must have been, even making the Tetons today, which are relatively young, look rather small. Anyway, we had them. And it was on this floodplain that the great host of mammals evolved, and we have anything you want, from rabbits to elephants, rhinoceroses, anything almost you just ask for it, and we have it in the way of the great mammalian class as it evolved here. In fact, I think I can say without fear of much contradiction that our Cenozoic rocks in Wyoming have contributed as much, if not more, to our knowledge of vertebrate evolution of the mammalian class from probably any other area of equal size to be found. And because they replete with these host of them. So here we have then. Well, time marches on. And we're ready now, the inevitable time the mountains lose of their substance. And interesting to note, actually, they are virtually destroyed. As far as figures of relief are concerned, they are torn down, destroyed, and they are being buried on their flanks by the rise of the sediments which are poured into them. And we're going to show you a picture now of what they look like. During this stage, there appears to have been remnants of their former grandeur rising 1,000 or 2 feet here and there above. And we have a high erosion, level erosion surface which came down to a mountain front which was seen by valleys. We're beginning to get some of the relief which we now see. And the filling by the Cenozoic rocks coming in and filling up, the same thing would apply to the other side. We would have a filling of these fully filled up to about that position, let's say, or to the crest of the falls. Here and here on the other side, we would have a few remnants. Rising modest above the surrounding region. But on the whole, the mountains had lost of their picture, and the flanking sediments had been built up. And in some instances, they had
continue building up until they spilled across as the cores of the mountains. These would be the Cenozoic rocks lying upon the folded Mesozoic rocks.
So we have then this addition.
Well, we have what we call actual remnants rising modestly 1,000 feet or so above a high level erosion surface, and this will have to fill up to here. Try and keep my color. Something like that. Picked up the wrong color. No. Yeah. This could go up the valleys and come out,
carrying them up. Very well, if we had journeyed into this region 10 million years ago or so, we would found it devoid of any marked relief, except here and there would be a remnant of the older mountains standing 1,000 or so feet as a regular. There are 3 of these remnants still visible as you go up the summit and look westward. You'll see the snowy range to the west rising 1,000 feet above that erosion surface. You'll see the Rawas and the Harlong's Peak complex. Now we're ready for the final event. The uplift of the whole region, rejuvenation, tilting and breaking. And in this, we find one of the anomalous situations characteristic of Wyoming, and that is the rivers of Wyoming are no respecter of the mountains. The self-respecting river flows out of the mountains or around the end of the mountains. Wyoming rivers have cut magnificent canyons right through the mountains. If you ever go down the Wind River to the Bighorn, Shoshone to Thermopolis, you go down the river all the way through the Wind River Canyon, 3,000 feet deep, 7 miles long. Only one. You ever see Split Rock up on Sweetwater? Did you ever go from Cody to Park? Heard of Cedar Mountains cut right off by a big canyon? Look at the little dam in it. It's everywhere. Hundreds of them. The river just didn't give a darn for the mountains because the mountains weren't there when the rivers were established. Because the rivers came in on this surface. They started here and they wandered across and went out narrowly toward the Great Plains. And in the ensuing time, the basins have been elevated, the mountains have been re-exhumed, and these magnificent canyons have been cut across the resistant rocks. And now the rivers get out and cross the mountains, and the basins have the mountains have come back as these sediments have been stripped down by re-exhumed, and they rise now 2,000-3,000 feet on their base. And the badlands are etched out of these younger sediments. Such are island-like remnants left in the valleys, and they are the so-called badland scarps, which are. And so we go back to it. And the floors of the valleys can only be lowered as speed at which the rivers can cut these canyons. And that's one reason why the floor of the Laramie Basin is still 7,000 feet high, because the Laramie River isn't a very powerful river, and they had to cut a 20-mile gorge across these old tough rocks, and it takes time. And so we come out now with the landscape as we know it, and just briefly in summation, we'll start with the crest of the actual remnants, rising 12,000-13,000 feet high. Breaking them will be broad dissected platforms from 9,000 to 11,000 feet high, a mountain front 2,500-3,000 feet high, the valley basin floors, and you can name it, the Laramie Basin, the Green River Basin, the Bighorn Basin, they all had a comparable history, and the adjacent rain. So the day when you travel on from Laramie, which is on the flank of the Mesozoic Rocks, you go up to the summit, What do you do? Here you go. That's a Volkswagen. You don't know what you're going, but you're going that way.
You slide over to Cheyenne on a constant gradient. After you hit the summit, about 40 feet to mile, and going right across the truncated is this great fault. Here, only one place is these sediments still in contact with the mountain front, and that's here, where they are, and we call it the gangplank, where they've been etched back, and they are. And that's what caused the line of the Mississippi Valley Road. Took a bridge across from the Great Plains to the Rocky Mountains without any change in grade. So that we have then, that's the typical landscape characteristic of Wyoming at the present time, incident to the last great period of uplift and breaking of the basaltic crust. That will conclude the presentation. I see I've extended all my time. Thank you for your attention, and I enjoyed talking to you.